once again. I'll be continuing my Bible study on the book of Romans. This is Pastor Panko from Trinity in Bay City. We're looking at chapter 7 today, under the life of the righteous, where you've got chapter 6, verse 1 through chapter 8, verse 39, where Paul talks about how for freedom Christ has set us free, which he talked to the Galatians about, and that's really could be used as a caption for the second division of Romans in chapters 5 through 8. So Paul now wants to show that Christians are free from the law, just as they're free from sin. He's still fighting the statement that justification without works of law means that a person is free to break the law, and that's not the case. So today he opens up what goes on in the heart of a Christian even, and it's interesting to see. So verses 1 through 6 are going to be talking about, well, this whole section talks about a life free from the law. And first of all, the verses 1 through 6 talk about how we are dead to the law through Christ. So we're going to look at verses 1 through 3. Hopefully these verses are big enough. It looks like they might be a little smaller than what I used to put on there, but hopefully you can magnify it on the screen and see it well enough. If not, open up your Bible. We'll be looking at Romans 7 here. This is in the Evangelical Heritage Version. Or don't you know, brothers, since I'm speaking to those who know the law, that a law has jurisdiction over a person only as long as he lives? For example, a married woman is bound to her husband by law as long as he's alive. But if he dies, she is released from this law regarding her husband. So then, she will be labeled an adulteress if she is joined to another man while her husband is alive. But if her husband dies, she is free from the law, and she is not an adulteress if she marries another man. So, first of all, Paul is talking about the law, okay, the moral law in this case, the well-known moral law. And he kind of sheds a new light on marriage laws, although just because it had never really been specified necessarily by the Word of God, but here he writes it out that it ends at death. Marriage ends at death, and this marriage law then relates to our relationship to the law, because he's saying that the law only has power over you as long as you're alive. Okay, just as marriage only has power over you as long as you're alive. There it is, as long as he is alive, so also then the law only has power over you as long as you're alive. So the life that he's talking about here, as long as you're alive, you think about that, is he talking about physical or spiritual? Remember, in the book of Ephesians, for instance, he talks about spiritual life versus physical life. In Ephesians chapter 2, he says, you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your sinful nature, things like that. So he's talking spiritual here. So general principle that law has power only when a man is alive is true of all laws. As statute, law controls a man only so long as he is alive physically. So a Christian is ruled by law so long as he is alive to sin spiritually. So in the past, some interpreters have understood this text allegorically. They say husband is our old man, wife is the new man. Others have said wife is the church. I would take it as a literal illustration of a principle. It only has power over you as long as you are alive. Okay? So, yeah, that's a little bit bigger on there now. Let's look at verse 4 then, okay? In the same way, my brothers, you also were put to death in regard to the law by the body of Christ, so that you may be joined to another, to the one who was raised from the dead, in order that we might produce fruit for God. So you notice what happened to our relationship to the law is that it was severed by death. He said, you also were put to death, okay, in regard to the law, all right? How did we die to the law? It says, by the body of Christ, or through the body of Christ. Remember in the last lesson what God did with the body of Christ. He crucified it. He buried it in the ground. And then in the last lesson in Romans 6, he talks about how when you're baptized, you're connected to Christ, and God takes your sinful nature. He takes you, and he crucifies you with Christ, and he buries you with Christ. So now we belong to Christ because he bought us with his blood. But it also then says that you are joined to another. You're not only joined to him in his death, but now you see what his resurrection means to us, because it says here also, he was raised from the dead. So imagine being married to, connected to a dead person. You wouldn't want to be married to a dead Savior any more than you'd want to be married to a dead spouse. But the picture here is that you're also raised with Jesus, and you're given life with Jesus. Why? So that you might produce fruit for God. You're supposed to be fruitful. Whatever you're married to, this is what you will produce. So when you're married, when a husband is married to a wife, you produce children that have your genes, have your likeness, end up with your same problems and your same strengths. Well, when we're married to Jesus, then we might produce fruit for God. So if you look at this agree or disagree question, the law is dead and no longer applies to us. Would you agree or disagree with that? The law is dead and no longer applies to us. Well, look at this statement right here. The law is dead? No. That would be disagree. The law is not dead. The law is alive and strong. It's still powerful. It still threatens. It still lays a claim on humanity. So there's only one way to freedom, and that is through the death of Christ. In Christ, the law and its threats are nailed to the cross. The law as slave master is dead for us as Christians. Okay? Paul put it this way in Galatians 2. Indeed, through the law, I died to the law, that I might live for God. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. So there you see what happens when we are with Christ now. All right? So God takes that living law, but then he crucifies it with Christ, and he puts it to death with Christ for the Christian. So it still is living and active, but we have an escape route through the death of Christ, who buried us with him. Okay, so let's try to go with the second one here. Okay, let's see here. So let's look at verses 5 and 6 now. For when we were in the flesh, strong sinful desires stirred up by the law were at work in our members, with the result that we produced fruit that results in death. But now we have been released from the law by dying to what held us in its grip, so that we serve in the new way of the Spirit and not in the old way of the letter of the law. So the role of the law here almost seems to take on the role of a tempter, okay? This is all a setup for verse 7 ultimately. But the new way of the Spirit is different from the old way of the written code in the attitude that is within. The unbelievers follow the law just as something external to follow, not because they want to, okay? And that's what we think about. Usually when you think of letter of the law, you think of what it says according to the hard line letter of it. But now we serve, says, in the new way of the Spirit and not in the old way of just doing it because that's what it says to do. Now we are gripped by the Holy Spirit, and we've been released from those threats of the law, the death of the law, All the letter of the law, okay? So here's another agree or disagree. If you don't want to, you shouldn't, okay? If we're going to say we serve in the new way of the Spirit, not in the old way of the letter of the law, sometimes you hear people say, well, if you're not doing it with the right motivation, then you really shouldn't do it. So let's say that somebody says to you, to a child, give your first fruits. So they earn their first paycheck in babysitting. And let's say they make $20. And the parent says, now, if you give 10%, you should give $2 to church. And the child says, well, I don't want to give that to church. Well, then should the child not give it because the child doesn't want to? If you don't want, will God accept it? Kind of like Cain's offering, will he accept it if he doesn't want to do it? Well, there you have the battle, right, that goes on between the old man and the new self, right? And then the old man never wants to do what God wants. He's always going to want to go the other way. He's always going to dig in his heels. And the new man, you know, this is the right thing to do. This is what God wants you to do. But you also struggle with this. In those situations, do you force, if a primary part of you doesn't want to do what God says, do you then force the old man to go this way if you especially have feelings that say, I don't want to? Well, you have to, you think about that. There are times you do things that you don't want to do. You know, parents probably don't like changing diapers too often. They don't want to do it, but that doesn't mean you shouldn't, okay? Sometimes you have to fight against your feelings and what your old man doesn't want to do or wants to do and still do it and hope that as you do so, that the new man then will enjoy the fact that he did what God wanted him to do even though he didn't want to do it. So these are some of the things that Paul is talking about now. As a Christian set free from the law, do I still do things that I don't want to do, or should I do them? If the law really can't condemn me, okay, if God really has damned Christ instead of me and I know I'm free, does that mean that I shouldn't do something if I don't want to? Not even the Christian life is the law able to bring forth fruit for God. If the law was a great power which increased sin, but wasn't able to bring forth anything good. So now in the new life, it suffers from the same impotence. There is no law that can give life. So, you know, when you give the law, God says strong sinful desires are stirred up by the law. So the nature of the law going on a sinful nature only makes people want to do the sin even more sometimes because of that sinful nature. So Paul is speaking about the Christians before and now, about what we were in the past and about what we are now. Now he's going to proceed, and we find the same temporal contrast. First, in verses 7 through 13, he discusses what the Christian was before, and then in 14 through 25, he sets forth what the Christian is now. So he's just talking about this conflict on the side. So 7 through 13, we're going to see how the power of the law as it provokes and increases sin. So Paul now answers the third main objection against justification, namely, if one must be freed from law to lead a holy life, this automatically makes the law an evil thing. Okay, so we're going to look at that some more. So let's look at 7 through 13 now. What will we say then? Is the law sin? Absolutely not. On the contrary, I would not have recognized sin except through the law. For example, I would not have known about coveting if the law had not said, you shall not covet. But sin, seizing the opportunity provided by this commandment, produced every kind of sinful desire in me. For apart from the law, sin is dead. Once I was alive without the law, but when this commandment came, sin came to life and I died. This commandment that was intended to result in life actually resulted in death for me. You see, sin, seizing the opportunity provided by this commandment, deceived me and put me to death through it. So the law is holy, and the commandment is holy, righteous, and good. Then did what is good become death to me? Absolutely not. But sin, so that it might be recognized as sin, brings about my death by this good thing, so that through this commandment sin might prove itself to be totally sinful. Okay, so first of all, you look in verse 7 about what the law showed Paul was sin. Okay, it showed him that coveting, where is that? Coveting is sinful. He wouldn't have known that it's sinful just to want something that God says you shouldn't have. Even an evil desire is sinful. So the law got him to recognize sin. Now remember the three purposes of the law, M, C, and G. So this would be mirror, curb, and guide. Now this reflects the mirror aspect of the law that shows you a sin that you wouldn't know was a sin. The other two, curb, keeps you from doing gross, immoral things, that keeps the world in order that way, and then guide shows you how to live a Christian life. That's for Christians primarily. For instance, Psalm 119, verse 32, your word is a lamp for my feet and a light for my path. So Paul here is talking about the written law that exposed this sin to him that he didn't have written on his heart, that or was at least very cloudy on his heart, and that when it wrote it down, when it said it in plain black and white, that's what made him realize that coveting was wrong. So you think about those then and how this affects, for instance, the idea of pornography. For those who say it serves a good purpose, it satisfies a need so that the men don't go out and commit rape or molest children. Well, that mentality couldn't be further from the truth, because the nature of sin is that which satisfies the sinful nature becomes dull after a while, and you need more and more of it, and actually eggs on towards those sin. It was interesting that Dr. Dobson had interviewed Ted Bundy, who had kidnapped and raped and murdered women, and he at least pointed back to the pornography that was in his household and how that fed his brain and his desires, and had a major part in what he did and how he treated women. So God is saying here, the thought process needs to be killed. The thought process needs to be damned. The thought process needs to be put to death. So you have to see what it is as it is, first of all. So you think about American society that has really given into the thought process of lust and no longer cares that much about it, and what effects that's going to have in our society, then it can lead to broken marriages. A man becomes addicted to those sites, and he gives all of his time and his attention, his energy toward the pornography instead of his wife, and that leads to many problems as well. Nygren was a commentator who wrote, "Man does not realize what a frightful power has him under its might and rules him. But then the law comes and exposes sin that was hidden up to that point. Just as the sun's rays call forth the possibilities that are in the seed and bring them to full growth, so the law calls forth sin that slumbers. Now it has the opportunity to develop its possibilities. The very commandment becomes a means which sin uses to its own purpose." Okay, so those are a couple of cross references there on that. And now we look at 8 through 12 a little bit more specifically. I'll read through those again. "But sin, seizing the opportunity provided by this commandment, produced every kind of sinful desire in me. For apart from the law, sin is dead. Once I was alive without the law. But when this commandment came, sin came to life and I died. This commandment that was intended to result in life actually resulted in death for me." You see, sin, seizing the opportunity provided by this commandment, deceived me and put me to death through it. So the law is holy, and the commandment is holy, righteous, and good. Then did what is good become death to me? Absolutely not, but sin, so that it might be recognized as sin, brings about my death by this good thing, so that through this commandment sin might prove itself to be totally sinful. So if you look at verse at these verses, sin, it says, seized the opportunity and came to life, okay, in a sense. It's an interesting way of putting it. Sin, seizing the opportunity provided by this commandment, produced every sinful desire. So it came to life within him. Sin came to life. So again, you think of the watering plant on the seed that causes the seed to grow. Law is the watering plant that causes the seed to grow. Well, law is not bad. Watering the ground isn't bad. It's the seed that's bad. If you put a wet paint sign up, inevitably somebody will go up and check if it says, don't touch wet paint. Inevitably somebody will say, go up to and touch it. The Candid Camera years ago did a spoof where they put a sign over a hole in the wall and they said, don't look in here. Well, inevitably people had to look in there. So the commandment made them want to do it. So sin is always there, but man doesn't know it is sin. It's dead as far as we know, but not dead. It's more like sleeping. It's for instance, it's 7 o'clock in the morning, whether I know it or not, and then my alarm tells me so. So the law points that out to you and makes you realize it. So Paul said this interesting statement, once I was alive without the law. Now, what does that mean? He said that referring to his time before his conversion, when he was a Pharisee, when he through work righteousness was the way to heaven. So when he says, I was alive without the law, he meant he thought he was alive. He felt he was good about himself. He was vibrant. He didn't have a guilty conscience because he was living the law. He was obeying the law. He felt great. But then when the commandment came and sin came to life, he died. So it really showed him who he was ultimately, and it pricked his conscience. So when Paul understood what God's will was, there was a total revision of his whole theological understanding. So when he was converted to Christ, then he realized what a sinner he was, and the law then put him to death. But he doesn't blame the law for that, okay? He blames sin for that, okay? It wasn't the law's problem. Sin seized the opportunity, and sin deceived me and put me to death through it, okay? So there's nothing wrong with the law. That's holy, righteous, and good. The problem is with sin that disobeys the law, okay? So if the law condemns us, brings death, you might say, how can it be holy, righteous, and good? Why is it holy, righteous, and good if it only condemns us and puts us to death ultimately? Well, if we don't see our sin, if we aren't put to death, then we can't live either. It's kind of like a seed. It needs to die before it sprouts forth. So Luther says, when the Lord God wants us to make us happy, he first of all makes us sad. And when he wants to make us rich, he first of all makes us poor. And when he wants to give us life, he first of all lets us die. So the law puts us to death before we can live. And Walther said, we must preach people into hell before we can preach them into heaven. And this is what the law does. An example of Jesus using the law in this way is in Luke 10, when an expert in the law wanted to know what he should do to inherit eternal life. And Jesus told him, love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, and all your mind. Love your neighbor as yourself. And he said to him, you've answered this correctly. Or the man said that. And Jesus said, you've answered this correctly. Do this and you'll live. So he's trying to show him his own sin by expounding on the law. And then it goes on to say that the neighbor, he's tried to justify himself about who's my neighbor, and Jesus said, told the story of the Good Samaritan, and the man went away sad, and he never did give the man any good news because the man never repented of his sin or wanted to find forgiveness in Jesus. So the purpose of the sin, he says here, is that so that through the commandment, sin might prove itself to be totally sinful. So the law's purpose is to show how totally sinful we really are. So we go on to verses 14 through 20. Certainly we know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual, sold as a slave to sin. For I do not understand what I am doing, because I do not keep doing what I want. Instead, I do what I hate. And if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. But now it is no longer I who am doing it, but it is sin living in me. Indeed, I know that good does not live in me, that is, in my sinful flesh. The desire to do good is present with me, but I am not able to carry it out. So I fail to do the good I want to do. Instead, the evil I do not want to do, that is what I keep doing. Now, if I do what I don't want to do, it's no longer I am who I'm doing it, but it is sin living in me. So throughout the centuries, the battle has been waged as to what this peculiar passage means. Who is the I to whom Paul here refers when he says, "I am carnal, sold under sin"? Confronted with such a statement, interpreters want to know whether the reference is to a converted person or to the unconverted. Is he speaking of his pre-Christian experience or of his experience as a Christian? The Greek church fathers generally understood Paul here to refer to those not yet Christian, to those still under the law. But Augustine was convinced that these statements are made about the Christian. Pietists who love to expound upon how great Christians can be and live such great Christian lives, they consider it utterly inconceivable that Paul might speak in this way about his new life as a Christian. But the answer is not as difficult as it seems. First of all, what tense? Look at what tense Paul uses in verse 14 as opposed to verse 13. So let's go back to verse 13 here. It says here, did what is good become death to me? Absolutely not. So he's talking about the past tense of what the law did to him. But now he says, I am unspiritual. He uses am. Present tense. Right now. Okay. Would Paul, you think about, would Paul as a Pharisee have had these struggles? That he was a slave to sin, that he didn't do what he was doing. No, he said that he was excelling as a Pharisee. If you look at what he says about himself, he was a Pharisee of Pharisees. He was a keeper of the law. He did everything according to it. He felt good about himself as a Pharisee. The subject that Paul has been talking about in the surrounding context is what does it mean to live in Christ, free from wrath, sin, law, and death? So why would Paul turn to a condition of someone under the law in this context and say about how free they are, how great they are? Paul was a Christian when he wrote this, obviously. So he's referring to what he is as a Christian. Now, the difficulty we have, though, is that God's word also says that sin shall not be your master. But this seems to have a low judgment as to Christ's ability to overcome sin in his life. He said that he uses that term as a slave to sin. Well, if sin isn't a master, then how can he be sold as a slave of the Christian? But the distinction here in this context is that the Christian has no want to do evil, And if we look a little bit further at this, hold on a second, then we see that what Paul is lamenting more than anything is that his will is not affected in corresponding action. It's kind of like when I go out to play basketball, and my will is that I will make the basket, that I'll be able to run, I'll be able to cut, but my body is sold as a slave to a 50-year-old, 51-year-old man who cannot do those things. So that's where the slavery is coming to from. And that's what Paul is talking about in this context. Nygren says, according to Paul, the soul of the Christian is not characterized by division and discord. He has in mind the tension that exists in the Christian life between will and action, between intention and performance. With that dualism in the Christian life, Paul is well acquainted. And that's in accord with what Paul wrote in Galatians 5:17. He said, the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the spirit. The spirit is what is contrary to the sinful nature. They're in conflict with each other, so you don't do what you want. So you have this conflict inside, outside. And you might think about this in your life as well, when it comes to doing family devotions, prayer time, visiting people. You want to do what's right, but your will is also torn here. Your body is torn here. Walther says this: to will what is good is the main trait of a Christian. Frequently, he does not progress beyond the good will to do something. Before he's aware of it, he's gone astray. The sin within him has come forth, and he's ashamed of himself. A Christian feels like a slave, with this difference, however, that he does not obey his master gladly as a Christian slave must obey. He renders obedience with the utmost reluctance. We have no right to denounce a person as an unchristian because he's not doing all that he should, as long as the person maintains that he does not will his imperfections. If he commits sin from weakness or in rashness, he can still be a Christian. So with that in view, that Paul is talking about a Christian, we can clearly say why the law is powerless to call forth the good. The law doesn't work, because it's spiritual, but we're unspiritual, okay, according to verse 14. A spiritual thing and an unspiritual thing. So, like trying to fit a square into a circle. Now, you might expect Paul to say the opposite here, that the law is unspiritual, but we as Christians are spiritual above the law. And that's the argument of many people who say that we don't need the law anymore. They say that the law has no relevance to a Christian. But the Christian has no right to set himself above the law. It's true that the law's main purpose is to point us to Christ, but we must not forget that the law is God's. It's given by God, an expression of God's holy will. It's actually spiritual. When it meets sin, however, it loses its ability to evoke the good and affect righteousness because of the sin in man. Paul insists on this point. Even the Christian is still carnal, not in the sense of carnal-minded, but in the sense that he still lives in the flesh. Christians still live as sinners among sinners, not as sinless saints among sinners. This explains how Christians are free from sin and yet subject to the condition of sin. So you think about somebody that might, John, a young man who might steal something from the store and say, and he gets caught and he tells his mom, I couldn't help it. The devil made me do it. Well, that's not a proper explanation because he still has the Holy Spirit living in him. He still has the desire to do what is good. He can still fight against it. You don't want to excuse it with the devil. But Paul's just talking about the great conflict that he has going on within. And as we as Christians, the better we understand this, the more comfortable we will be with grace also. Because it's when we have those conflicts that we oftentimes wonder, what's going on in my mind? How come I'm having these emotions, these desires, these thoughts? And you think, if I'm a Christian, I won't have these things. But that's a product of living in a sinful body with a sinful mind, with a sinful heart, with sinful hands, that the Holy Spirit who lives within you and the new man within you has to fight against that. And that's what Paul is talking about here. Law is a good thing. God wants you to do good things, but you still have that unspiritual part that's been sold as a slave to sin, freed from its power by the grace of God, but you still have to fight against it, and it still wins its battles. So I used the illustration before of being having a Siamese twin that was beating you up and causing you to do all kinds of things, and somebody comes and shoots it, puts it to death. Well, it can't tell you what to do anymore, but it still slows down your life and stinks up your life, and you can't do what you'd like to with that dead body along your side, but at the resurrection you will. So we look then finally at the final four verses. So I find this law at work. When I want to do good, evil is present with me. I certainly delight in God's law according to my inner self, but I see a different law at work in my members, waging war against the law of my mind and taking me captive to the law of sin, which is present in my members. What a miserable wretch I am. Who will rescue me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then I myself serve the law of God with my mind, but with my sinful flesh I serve the law of sin. So even though the sinful nature is dead, it can still drag you down. So it says evil is still present there with you. And he then makes reference to the inner self, right? Which is different from the sinful self. And so there's a different law, a different pattern at work here in his members, waging war against the law of my mind, keeping me captive to the law of sin, which is present in my members. So how does Paul, and how are we rescued from this terrible battle? Here it is. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Okay, that's where the rescue is. So the law ultimately is meant to show us our sin so that we know we need a Savior. And that's where Jesus comes to the rescue. And ultimately then, are we rescued from the body of death, ultimately in the resurrection from the dead, and also when our bodies die and our souls are taken to heaven, but ultimately at the resurrection. But also, I guess, yeah, you would say through death. So Nygren says here the passage, it fills the important function of knowing that the law can never, under any circumstances, be a way of salvation, not even for the Christian. And that's important, isn't it? The law is not a way of salvation for the Christian. It still damns, it still condemns. But it's meant then ultimately to drive us to Jesus, who is the gospel, who is the Savior. Through the law, no man, not even the Christian, becomes righteous. It's not in this sense that Christ is, Nygren says, it's not in this sense that Christ is our righteousness, namely that he gives us the power to keep the law and we then become righteous by keeping it. Were that the case, there would be no fundamental difference between righteousness by the law and righteousness by faith. The gospel is not just a means for the establishment of the righteousness of the law, but the gospel of Christ is the very righteousness of God. To be in Christ is full and complete righteousness. That is to be justification apart from the law. That is to be free from the law without reservation. So, we're free from the condemnation of the law. We're free from the damnation of the law in Christ. But we still, with our sinful flesh, serve the law of sin. Okay? But now that we're saved freely through Jesus Christ, we serve the law of God with our mind, but serve the law of sin with the flesh. So that's the conflict. But this, serving the law of God with my mind, is not what saves us. Jesus is what saves us, the gospel. He's just contrasting the two different laws that are at work within his members. The one, again, you got sinful nature, old man, new man. The new man wants to serve the law of God, and this one wants to serve the law of sin, okay? This law of God, and the law of sin. So which law are you going to serve? I'm going to serve this law, but even the way I serve it isn't what saves me. I need the gospel and Jesus to save me. Paul's just talking about the struggles we have as Christians. So this part sometimes gets confusing for people to read. When Paul talks about these two laws at work within his members, the inner self, and then the new man, the old law, the new law, all these things, the power of the law. I hope, you know, as you go through this, you understand the difficulty that we have, but that's through the law, the good law, that meant to lead us to Jesus. If you're still confused, maybe read it again, watch the video again, or open up the People's Bible too, and see what it has to say. Also, just keep on reading through Romans. Paul's going to keep clarifying this as we go. God bless your day.